Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. So we've been on a little bit of a hiatus. We just finished up our shelves and drawer units build. I've taken a couple of weeks off. Typically this is what happens around the beginning of January. And once we start heading into February, we get some steam rolling and we get going back on with some more projects. And in fact, I'm working on a project right now, which is this right here. What you see is just some beautiful cherry that we've had sitting around for a little while now. It's had a chance to darken up, although it hasn't been exposed to sunlight. And the sunlight will really help to make this darken up, especially if we had like some boiled linseed oil or something. That would really, really give it that dark look. But we're going to start with this. And this is going to be a mirror frame. In fact, my wife's been complaining for a long time that we don't have a mirror behind the bedroom door. If she wants to see something full length, she has to walk through the house to head over to a closet that we have where inside there we have a full-size frame, or a mirror, excuse me. So I'm going to make this for her. And we're going to experiment around a little bit. I was just going to make it just a typical rectangular one, kind of, I don't want to say blah, just kind of very plain looking. But I think we might add a few features in here, maybe like a lamb's tongue with a chamfer. We'll leave what we're supposed to be horns. We'll leave them proud. But rather than getting into that too much, we'll come back and talk about it. And in fact, one thing, if you can kind of see back here, I'm just going to leave this a little bit of a teaser. You'll have to maybe like really stop and take a look at it. There's a neat little tool that I picked up from Lee Valley, and it's going to help me make custom dowels. And what we're going to do is maybe put some like accent pieces in here with some walnut that I have left over. I know it's kind of weird, it's like dark on top of dark, but I think it's going to accent it really nicely. So anyways, we'll see more about that as this build project comes together. It's been a lot of fun, a little bit of hand tools, a little bit of power tools, but more importantly, just fun. That's the main thing. One thing I want to talk to you about today, kind of a short informational thing. Remember back episode 470, we did the simple, super simple box that we made for my wife's business. And in there, you saw how I separated the pieces that were going to make the top and the bottom. And a number of you said, that's really great. It looks fantastic. Is there maybe a quicker way you could do this? Well, one thing that we've always talked about is the fact that you oftentimes would see when somebody's building a box that they'll put the box together and then afterwards come back and then make the one cut right down the center to separate the top and the bottom. Of course, we wanted that friction fit in there, so we needed to have a tongue and a groove, which ordinarily wouldn't be a problem. We could maybe come on the one side and get it, but of course we're going to have a lip on the inside. Anyways, without getting too crazy about it, go back and you can watch the episode. One way that I came up with it to take care of that was, of course, that I would split the piece in half, and then I would have to set up a sacrificial fence on my table saw on the rip fence, and then I would have to make two passes. And while it still made it super simple because I got to the point where I could get through it rather quickly, it still seemed like there was something else we could do to make it go a little bit faster. Now, one of you listeners actually sent in the information. In fact, I can't remember offhand as I'm recording this. I'll make sure to give you credit here at the bottom. You mentioned the fact that there was a great topic over at Fine Woodworking Magazine, an article, and I will make sure again to have links in the show notes so you can get there to check this out. If you have a digital subscription, of course, you'll be able to download the PDF. If not, it might be a reason to consider getting it because there's some fantastic PDFs over there, some great articles you can check out. Anyways, though, in this article, it described a technique that very similar to getting the box assembled and then making that one single cut around the edge. This, you make a pre-cut for where you want the inside lip to be, and then once you have the box assembled, you can go around and do that complete cut all the way around. Well, I didn't do it exactly that way, but I followed the technique. So let's take a quick look at this. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is I want to make that first kerf cut that's going to kind of create the first, we're going to call it a half flap joint. So we're going to make the one that's going to be on the inside of the box. I know that I want the kerf to be, that the lip to be 7/8 of an inch down from the top of the box. So I go ahead and I set my rip fence for 7/8 of an inch. I've already made my practice cuts to see where it is that the blade needs to be height-wise so that I can get a perfect half lap. So when I bring it together, they're going to be nice and flush. Take your time on this one. Get some scrap material that's the same exact size as what you're working with so that you can make these practice cuts and get it perfect. Don't rush into this part. If you're going to spend a little extra time, this is where you want to spend that time. But once we get this done, it's going to go even faster than what we did before. So we make that first cut at 7/8 of an inch. And then now what I'm going to do is I'm going to flip the piece over and I'm ready to make a second cut that's going to actually allow it to split open. This piece is going to be on the opposite face of the one that we just cut. I adjust the rip fence for the total the height that I need for where I want that lip, that half lap to start. I hope that's not too confusing. You can see the video right here. I get it lined up and I make sure that it might be just a little over so that it's going to line up more with the previous cut we made. Now that we've got that done, we'll just simply go ahead and make the cut as we push it through. As I finish it, you can kind of see that the piece still stays together, and it looks like it's, you know, like I didn't complete the cut. It's just a matter of almost like a Kit Kat. Leave it to a fat guy to make a reference about a candy bar when talking woodworking, but it's almost like a Kit Kat, and you just kind of break it a little bit, and it comes apart. It should only be a small amount of fibers that are holding it together. You pull it apart, and there you go. You have now a piece. Your sides are exactly the way you want them, and we only had to really make one setup on the fence. It was just a matter of adjusting it. No having to deal with test cuts, no having to deal with really tiny pieces. We work with that one piece all together and we get a really great result. In fact, I'm really stoked about it because I think it easily knocked about like 10, almost 20 minutes off of my assembly time, which means I can just work that much faster. I'm gonna have to get brave enough to try using the technique where I glue it all up and then make that second cut, but you know, we'll come back and maybe take a look at that one and I'll give you a sneak peek on that too. One thing I will say is if you notice that maybe you have a little extra fibers or there's a little bit of piece that's kind of hanging there a little bit on the edge of it, just take your two pieces that you had and kind of rub them together. You'll do a little bit of a rub joint there and that will clean it up. It'll clean it very nicely, almost as if you're touching it up with sandpaper or even a hand plane. And that's going to do it. So when it comes down to it, really super simple. Thanks for the suggestion. I'm really glad we had this. This is one of the purpose of the podcast. Hopefully I'll teach you something. More importantly, I'm trying to get you to teach me something so that I can share it with all of you. And this was a really great tip. Again, I really appreciate it. And like I mentioned, this is over at Fine Woodworking Magazine. That's where the original article came from. And you can see even more great things from this article. I just borrowed this one single aspect of it and got a really great result. So with that said, I think we're gonna pretty much kind of wrap this up. Again, we got the projects going on. We got the mirror. We have finishing up a Ron Hawk smoother. I'm gonna make sure we get that going. And I've got definitely some big plans coming up pretty soon, something I'm hoping all of you will be able to appreciate and really enjoy, and more importantly, learn something from. So make sure you get yourself entered for the swag drawing. As this is going up, as this is being posted, we have like 1 or 2 days left to get the January ones. I'm probably going to draw the names February 1st or February 2nd, depending on how lazy I am. This cold weather really makes me just want to just lay on the couch and watch movies and not do much else. But of course, we got to get down to the shop and do something. I mean, hey, that's what the shop's there for. I mean, it's half the excuse I used to buy the stuff, right? Because I was going to build stuff. Anyways, though, enough babbling. Get a hold of me, mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. If you have any more suggestions or if you have any questions or maybe a topic idea that you'd like to see covered. Or, of course, you can stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com where you can leave a comment on any of the posts that we have. And, of course, you can even leave a comment about today's post. And, more importantly, you can get yourself entered for the free swag. And I just want to remind everybody, of course, to help support the show because while we do have sponsors, we still have to pay some of the bills around here. If you click on any of our links for our advertisers and make purchases, it definitely helps out with the show because, well, obviously they like to keep advertising. And more importantly, you get something for your shop while you're also helping out the show. And who doesn't like getting something for yourself? I mean, I do. But anyway, so enough. I'll be talking to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. Come back pretty soon. We're going to get some more projects going. Like I said, we got this nice mirror frame going on. And so many more. See you later.